Good morning, everybody. So first order of business, everybody has to be polite because my daughter is here. She's 2.5 years old. She still thinks I'm awesome. What's that? Okay. Hello there in the back. Thank you very much for coming. So my name is Steve Silberman. I'm from AudioQuest. My role at AudioQuest is mostly in product development. I work on projects like Dragonfly. Has anybody here ever heard of Dragonfly? Okay, cool. Anybody here bought one? Anybody paying for Montessori school? Thank you. I also work on projects like Beetle, which is a new DAC we have coming out, and Jitterbug. If you guys have heard of Jitterbug, we make a little USB filter. I'll show you a little bit of that later. These are tricky seminars for somebody like me to do because I am a manufacturer. I sell products. You already know that. You're here because you want me to tell you something that you don't know. You want to learn things about computer audio, networking, so on and so forth. I will demonstrate some of AudioQuest products. There is a point to that. It could be my product. It could be WireWorld. It could be Nordost. I happen to work for AudioQuest. The other companies I mentioned are legitimate companies that engineer and manufacture legitimate product. But I do want to show ways to make your system better. So what I like to do is I like to break it up into two parts. First, I want to show you the fundamentals. How do we get everything? Oh, and if everyone could set their phones to stun, that would be great. Everyone set your phone to silent. Thank you. What I want to do is I want to break it up into two parts. I want to work on the fundamentals and give you a quick run through on settings and optimization, things that don't relate to accessories like cables or jitterbugs or things like that. And then I'm going to have a little bit of fun and show you what some tweaks can do to your system. Anybody here interested in tweaking their system? Okay. I want to get a baseline too. I want to get a feel for what everyone's comfort level is here. Who here is already doing computer audio? Raise your hand. Okay, this is great. That's fine. You're in the game. That's fantastic. Who here is a beginner? Okay. Who here feels they're sort of at an intermediate stage? Okay. And who is advanced? Okay. And Jim has no opinion whatsoever. He's neither advanced, beginner, or intermediate. So who's using Windows? Okay. And who's using Mac? And anybody using Linux? Okay. I won't cover Linux. If you're a Linux user, you don't need me. That's why you're a Linux user. But I will cover, I'll cover some things that are pertinent to both Mac and to Windows. Who's doing network audio? Who's using the router and Ethernet or Wi-Fi in their house to do audio? Okay, decent amount. So I'm going to cover both. Who's doing locally connected, USB, Toslink, HDMI? Okay, this seems to be the majority. It's interesting. It's cultural. When we're in Europe, nobody uses USB. And when we're in the United States, almost nobody uses networking. It just worked out that way for whatever reason. It's just the way the world works. Yeah, and over in Europe, predominantly, it's all about hi-fi. Home theaters, almost non-existent over there, comparatively speaking. So I'm going to, this is going to happen from time to time. I'm going to walk you through and talk about some of the basic fundamentals in terms of the computers. I'm using a MacBook Pro here. We should all start thinking about our computers. When we're building a stereo system, think of your computer as a component. How many people have a dedicated computer in their stereo system? Okay, and how many people use their computer and their stereo system for the rest of their lives? Not too many. Halfway. We always suggest that people should, if you buy a computer just as you would buy a stereo component, buy it as a dedicated device and put it in your stereo system and leave it there. So here are some of the things that we've found, both we found and we've also learned from people in the pro audio world, because they've been doing this far longer than we have. Here are some of the things that we know make a difference in terms of the sound of your computer. You want to get the highest performance computer that you feel comfortable spending money on. So in this example here, this computer is a MacBook Pro with the latest quad-core processors. I have 16 gigabyte of RAM in here, and I have an SSD hard drive. So let me cover a couple of those things. The more processing power you have, it seems the better the computer sounds. Quad cores sound better than dual cores. I don't think there are single cores to be found anymore. The pro world has known this for decades. RAM is your best friend. The more RAM you can get, the better the system will sound. Consumer computers seem to be maxing out now at around 16 gigabyte of RAM, but if you went into a recording studio, they'll typically use something like a big Mac Tower workstation, and they'll have anywhere from 32 to 64 to 128 gigabyte of RAM. But they're also running programs that require a lot more overhead than the product, the programs we're going to be running. But what we recommend is, at a minimum baseline, we find that 8 gigabyte is where you want to be. And so, kind of just to give you an example, if I go into my computer and I go into Activity Monitor and I look at how much resource I'm using right now in my RAM. Hi, Rosie. So I've got 16 gig of RAM and my computer just idling with nothing running. Nothing is running, and I'm using three gigabyte of memory. If I opened my browser, if I opened Firefox, or if I opened Safari, that would take another two right there. So I'd be at 5 gigabyte of memory. If I had Word documents and Excel spreadsheets and Outlook running, I would be at 9 gigabyte of memory right out of the gate. So you can see why we typically like to recommend a minimum of 8 gigabyte of RAM. It's better to have more overhead than to have less. And RAM has gotten unbelievably cheap now. So sort of our rule of thumb is 16 gigabyte of RAM if you're comfortable spending the money on that. 8 gigabyte should sort of be your minimum mandatory. The other thing I mentioned was a hard drive in my computer. There's a solid state hard drive in the computer, but the key here is I'm not storing any of my music in the computer. All of my music is going to be external. Solid state drives sound better than spinning disk drives by quite a margin, whether the music is stored there or not. They have faster access, their read-write speeds are better, they have lower resource overhead. So what I recommend is about a 256 gigabyte is sort of a minimum mandatory I would recommend for your hard drive. And all we're going to be running here is the operating system and all of our player applications. So the operating system in this case is OS X, and my applications are going to be things like iTunes, JRiver, and Rune. But again, I'm not putting any of my music on here. What I want is a very fast, a very reliable, a very quiet and dynamic hard drive for the infrastructure of my computer audio system. So that covers the basics. That covers the basics of what you want in terms of your computer. Okay. Mac Minis are spectacular. They're very cost effective. If someone's doing a stereo or home theater that has video in it, I have a stereo system with a plasma. We use the Mac Mini at home, and we use HDMI out into that, so it's very cost effective. We've bought just the computer, but we take advantage of the screen we already own. If you want a laptop, will actually sound a little bit better than something like a Mac Mini or a desktop, because these are held to a higher standard by the FCC for radiation. These are much quieter, laptops in general. Whether it's a Windows PC or it's a Mac, laptops tend to sound better. With all other things being equal, if I looked at a Mac Mini with comparable processing and RAM and the same hard drive, my laptop typically will sound quite a bit better than that because it's a quieter system. There's less radiation being emitted by it. So I prefer laptops, but there's a cost premium to those. That's the one downside to it. So that kind of covers what I would suggest, what we would suggest for computers. It seemed like, yes?
What about all-in-ones? Would that be the same thing?
The all-in-one?
Just a monitor that houses the computer?
Oh, like an iMac. Something like the iMac computer. They don't sound that great. I'm glad you brought that up. They're real noisy, and those screens that they come with are extremely noisy as well. So they're cost effective, and you get a lot for the money. But from a sonic perspective, they can be a little bit tricky. But we can talk about ways to mediate that, where you can get rid of that noise from getting into your stereo system.
Does it make a difference if you store the music on the SSD inside the laptop versus external?
It does. That's the next section I'm going to get into. He wanted to know if it makes a difference where you store your music, and I'm going to talk about that. One last question.
Sorry.
I have to see what the older laptop looked like. I'd have to see what a Mac and what level of processing. Oh, okay. So, like, yeah, I would rather have I'd probably rather have a 2 or 3 year old Mac laptop than the latest and greatest Mac Mini at this point. Yeah. Yeah. There was a brief period where Mac Minis came with quad-core processing, and they disappeared for years, and then they came back for 3 months, and then disappeared again. I was lucky enough to get a quad-core Mac Mini, but they're hard to find. You can find them on eBay, and most people who are selling their old quad-core Mac Minis don't realize that there's any value to them as an audio component. So you usually can find a really good deal on one of those online. So you asked a great question, kind of a perfect lead-in. Where should I store my music? So we store our music externally, and I'll tell you why. The internal hard drive in here is constantly pulling and pushing information to run the operating system. If you're running applications like JRiver or iTunes or add-ons like Amara and Pure Music, those are also pulling and pushing a lot of data. There's a lot of traffic on the bus for that internal hard drive. There's not a lot of freeway left for moving your music around. What we find is if you can store your music externally, it'll sound considerably better, especially if you can store it over something like Thunderbolt. And the reason why Thunderbolt sounds so good is it's basically a PCI port. So you've got a port or a bus that has no other traffic on it. So your internal hard drive, which has your operating system, has all of its own dedicated and discrete traffic. And this external hard drive is going to have its own traffic pathway, and the two aren't going to congest one another. So an external hard drive can sound quite a bit better. But there's a caveat. So everyone who's doing USB audio, raise your hand. If you're doing USB, keep your hands up. Okay, now keep your hand up if you have a USB DAC and a USB hard drive. Okay, a lot of people have moved on from that. What happens is you get a lot of conflict on the bus when you're doing that. You're asking the bus to speak two languages at the same time. You're asking it to speak Portuguese and English at the exact same time. What I mean by that is these hard drives work on a bulk protocol. So the bus is trying to speak to that in bulk. My DAC is working on an isochronous asynchronous protocol. So having a USB hard drive and a USB DAC is going to seriously diminish the playback quality of your music because the bus is having a hard time trying to move that data in both directions in two different languages at the same time.
How would you compare the benefit of Thunderbolt to plugging, say, SSD directly into a SATA? Obviously not a laptop.
You know, I haven't compared that because I haven't had a SATA port on my computer in so many years. But when I look at the resource requirement of Thunderbolt, it's incredibly low, and the throughput is incredibly high. You know, you have the potential to move 10 gigabytes per second. So the actual bus is faster than any hard drive you could buy. I find that Thunderbolt is my preferred setup, and I'll talk about a couple of the other external setups, but eSATA, I haven't found in so long on any of the computers. Mac hasn't supported it since they discontinued the 17-inch computer.
I was just talking about SATA right into the motherboard.
I'm not going to get into doing something of that kind. I'd have to modify my computer to do that, and I don't want to do that.
What about I have an SSD running my OS, but then I took out the optical drive and I put in a hard drive inside of there. Is that
a second drive? Second drive will typically have its own bus.
Okay.
Yeah, depending on the architecture of the computer. It'll typically have its own bus. I've got an engineer from Intel shaking his head and cooperating. So this is we're going to have a judge and jury. This is our judge and jury. He's an engineer from Intel and works on all this stuff. So yeah, that's totally fine. I had a computer a few years ago that I took out the old optical CD drive and then I put a hard drive in there for economy of space when I'm traveling, and it was perfect, yeah. I find the best way to connect, the best sound I get is through Thunderbolt from my external hard drive. The next best way to go would be a network-attached storage device. Okay, is everybody familiar with a NAS? If anybody's not familiar with a NAS, raise your hand. It's totally fine. Okay, great. A NAS is an intelligent quasi-computer hard drive. When I say quasi-computer, a NAS would have a hard drives built into it, and it would have its own computer processor built into it, and it would have a very basic Linux operating system. And NAS connects to your router or to the switch, connects to the network. So what's nice about a NAS is all the computers in your home can see it because it shows up as a network-connected device. Okay, does that make sense? They're very, very easy to use. They're very, very easy to set up. Rick, who works with me at AudioQuest, just bought a NAS and sent me an email a few days ago and said, "Well, this sucks."
I didn't say that.
I can pull up your email. I'm paraphrasing.
Yeah, thank you.
Rick was disappointed in the sound that he was getting from his NAS. Rick has an enterprise-grade network in his home. Okay, so his network is real serious. You could run a small Fortune 500 company from Rick's living room. And he was kind of stunned that the network attached storage device didn't sound as good as he thought it would sound. So I asked him, well, what did you get? And I think you said you got a Western Digital?
Buffalo.
Sort of the same difference, but yeah. I went down this road too. When I first started doing network audio, I bought an inexpensive Western Digital, which is kind of similar to the Buffalo, and I was disappointed with it. And I talked to some friends in the industry that were deeper into this at that time. And Chris Conacher from Computer Audio File had suggested to me, what you really want to get is either a Synology or a QNAP. So I wound up buying a Synology network attached server, and it sounded pretty good. It sounded quite a bit better than my Western Digital by a substantial margin. So then I started poking around and asking questions like, this is good, how can I make it better? And he said, oh, you can improve the RAM in your network attached server. So a lot of these are upgradable. I have 8 gigabytes of RAM on my network attached server that goes into my network, and any of my computers in the home can then pull music from that. And with the Synology running at 8 gigabytes of RAM with a dual core processor, I find that that sounds as good or so close that I don't care to this. So there's a nice flexibility to that. I can have a computer in my living room which runs my main stereo system, and in my office I can connect my computer to the network and I can pull music there too. The other thing I like about the NAS is I set it up where it has its own HTML address. So if I'm on the road for AudioQuest and I'm in Hong Kong and I think I really want this one song, I can literally log on to my NAS. It would do just like this. I would go here and I would just go connect to server, and then there's the address for my server and the password is protected, and I can go ahead and just grab the music right from there. So NAS are very, very powerful, but they're not all created equal. So if you're going to store your music, if you're going to store your media externally, our two preferred connections are Thunderbolt and a NAS. And if you're going to get a NAS, we strongly urge that you get either a QNAP or a Synology. Now, when you buy your NAS, they come empty. What I mean by that is they don't come with hard drives. You have to then select the hard drives. There's a couple of sites that I peruse where they do test benching on hard drives. And right now, across the board, on every enthusiast and network site that I go to, the HGST Hitachi hard drives are rated higher than anybody else's in terms of reliability, durability, lifespan. So when you go to buy hard drives for these external NAS, I suggest right now at this moment, Hitachi seems to be the king of the hill. That's if you're using a spinning disk. The optical spinning disks. Now, when you buy an optical spinning disk drive, you want a high RPM. I think highest RPM right now is 7,200 RPM. Higher RPM drives sound significantly better. And then the cache and the read-write speeds have an effect on the sound of the system. So when you buy your hard drive, buy the highest RPM and buy the ones with the fastest read and write speeds with the largest cache. Those things all seem to coincide with better fidelity.
What about solid state?
I haven't used hybrids. I don't know why I haven't tried it yet. I've kind of been, I continue to wait for solid state to come down. The difference in sound from solid state drive to spinning disk drives is humongous. It's the Grand Canyon. It's huge. We're all waiting. Problem is I have 8 terabytes worth of music and movies at home. I'm going to be waiting for a while. So I'm still in the spinning disk world.
Question.
You mean Thunderbolt? This is Thunderbolt, which is a variant of PCIe.
But it's not a USB port.
No, it's a Thunderbolt port. It's a totally unique port. Thunderbolt is owned by partially owned by Apple and by. Can you say it? It's not IBM. It's Intel. Sorry, Intel. I couldn't think of it. Vast majority of it is Intel. It's an Intel system. There are a number of Windows computers that come with Thunderbolt, but it's.
You can also put a card.
You can put a card. If your computer has a card slot, you can get a card that takes you from PC, an express card to Thunderbolt.
Okay, but the port of
itself?
It's a proprietary port. Yeah.
So it wouldn't be on like older Toshiba laptops.
No, we're looking really the last 4 or 5 years. It's shown up. It's shown up. But yes, Rick.
Operating system versus solid state drive.
There's a mic right in front of you, sir.
There's a microphone in front of
me. Am I there? With Chris Conacher, we compared solid state drives with the operating system on them versus solid state drives with the music storage on them, and then the combination of the two. And at that time, at least, by far the greatest improvement was, which was good news, especially then, was the operating system being on the solid state drive as opposed to the music. Just for the record.
And that's what I found too. So that's good feedback that other people in the field are finding the same thing. Okay, so where was I? We've pretty much gone through all the hardware. Let's jump into applications. Let's talk about music applications. Who here is using iTunes in any capacity? Okay, cool. Who here is using JRiver? How about FUBAR? Okay, a couple people, Linux users. Who's using Rune? A couple people. Okay, cool. And JRiver and Linux, which is really cool. Yeah. I'll start with iTunes. It takes 2 minutes to go through iTunes. There's two reasons I want to go through iTunes. It's easy, it's ubiquitous. And get this, guess how many iTunes, active iTunes accounts there are on the planet right now? Over 900 million people have an iTunes account now. That, in and of itself, we could argue defines as a standard, just like CD was once a standard and cassette was once a standard and LP was a standard. iTunes, for better or worse, is a standard. You know, we're along for the ride. We're just along for the ride. So let me go ahead and launch iTunes real quick. iTunes is going to default to the lowest common denominator. You got to keep in mind that the majority of the people with iTunes accounts, they have iTunes accounts only because they have an iPad or an iPhone. Yeah, and very few people are not going to go into iTunes and maximize it for audio quality. But Steve Jobs was genuinely an audiophile, so he made sure that when the preference tree was developed and when preferences were established, that this could be a program that people who cared about their music could still use as a management and curation device. So what we do is we go into preferences. I went to iTunes and I launched my preferences, and this is the first menu that it brings up. First thing I want to do is go to import settings. The way that this is going to ship to all computers is set to the AAC encoder, and it's going to be set to 128 kilobytes. That's what everybody's iTunes looks like when they first open it up. That means when I put a disk into my computer and start ripping my catalog, it starts ripping it at 128 kilobytes. So what I want to do is I want to change that to what's called an AIFF encoder and leave that set to automatic. Okay. So what this means, when I set to an AIFF encoder, it means I'm ripping my CDs bit for bit, kilobit for kilobit. CDs are 1411 kilobytes per second. When I set it to AIFF, I'm going to make an identical copy, same file size, everything. It's going to be 100% identical to the original CD, as long as I have error correction selected. One of the other things that happens with iTunes is when it ships, this is turned off. Use error correction when reading audio CDs. So let me tell you how this works. Let's say that you got a disc that was pressed poorly, or your disc has some scratches or some blemishes or some imperfections on it. While the disk drive is reading your disc to copy the data, it may get to an area where it's hard to read. If this is turned off, it'll literally jump over that area that's hard to read and continue to read, and it'll interpolate and make up the data that it didn't get. The bits that it didn't acquire will be made up. It will fill in the gaps, but it will do it by guessing. When you turn this on and the disk drive gets to an area where it's hard to read the disk, it'll poke around and camp out until it gets that data. At some point, after a long period of time, it may decide that there's no hope and it may move on. But this will ensure with a 99.99999999% assurity that when you copy your compact disc, you've copied it so that it's exactly the size of the file and you've copied it so that it's bit perfect. So iTunes has a perfectly competent bit perfect ripper in it so long as you select that. Now some people will choose something like Apple Lossless because what they can do is they can cut their file size by about 40%. So when you use Apple Lossless or FLAC, you can cut your file size in half with mono recordings because the left and the right are 100% identical. The stereo recordings, you can't cut it in half, but you can cut maybe somewhere between 35 to 42, 43% of the file size down. It's been our observation that while Apple Lossless and FLAC are both supposed to be bit perfect, which they are totally bit perfect when ripped properly, there seems to be a different sonic footprint to them. And I prefer the sonic footprint of something like AIFF or WAVE. Now, the reason I don't suggest WAVE, if you look here, there's also a WAVE encoder. AIFF and WAVE are essentially the same thing with some semantical differences. They are full-size file rippers, but WAVE has a very difficult time retaining metadata. So what is metadata? Metadata is this cover art you see here for this U2 album or J.J. Cale. Metadata is the album title and all the track titles that you see here. That's called metadata. When you rip your CDs in WAVE, the first time you rip the CD, you can get the metadata. You can get the cover art, the album title, the song title. But as soon as you back that hard drive up, you lose all that data. There's no hooks between WAVE and the metadata. So if you ripped 100 discs, 10 songs per disc, you had 1,000 songs, you just have file 1 through 1,000. You wouldn't know what they were. So don't use WAVE, just use AIFF. And let me go back in here to our preferences and go into advanced. The next thing is location. The default location for your iTunes music library will be to dump your library right into the internal hard drive. So what you want to do is you want to change that. You'll hit change, it'll bring up a finder menu, and you can see under devices I have an external hard drive that I've titled media. And so that's where I will keep all of my music. And now this is... And that's it. That's all you need to know for iTunes.
Where did you do that? Can you show that?
Sure. You go into iTunes, you go into preferences, you go into advanced, and then what you do is you go here where it says change, and that will bring up this location. So then I can go, yeah. I don't know how I made that so big. Okay, so that's it for iTunes. There's really not a whole lot you need to do for iTunes to make it good, or make it acceptable. Now the other thing that you need to do when you're connecting your computer, let's just talk about if you're a Mac user, you'll have to go into what's called your audio MIDI setup. You'll actually have to tell the music where you want it to play. iTunes doesn't know where you want the music to play. It's just gonna default to what's called the built-in output. So this is my built-in output, and when you launch the MIDI for the first time, this is what it's going to look like. So you can see here, I've got a number of options with this system. I can play music theoretically over HDMI. It senses a projector. It doesn't know the projector doesn't have speakers. I've got the Pioneer USB device, and then I have a device driver that I'm not using. So I want to use this Pioneer. This is a really cool DAC from Pioneer called the N50. I think this sells for $699. It does asynchronous USB. It does networking, it does coax and Toslink. It's a very nice device. I've been using this for years. What I want to do is I want to tell the computer where to play my music to. So I'm going to highlight the Pioneer USB. I'm going to go ahead and select that device, and there we go. Now the next thing you got to pay attention to is your sample rate. This is my biggest pet peeve with iTunes. iTunes doesn't look at the file, look at what the sample rate is, and automatically adjust your computer to the native sample rate. Typically, when you open a MIDI for the first time, it'll be set to something like 96. My files, if I have 6 terabytes worth of music, I would say 500 gigabytes of that is high-resolution music. The rest of it is 1644, because that's what everything's really been sold in. I want to make sure that when I play my music, it's played in the sample rate. The computer outputs it at the sample rate of the native file. So this is one of the persnicketies that I have with iTunes. I have to change this every single time I change to a different file format. So if I listen to an album that's 44.1, and the next album I listen to is 96, I have to manually change that. And that's kind of, it's These are first world problems. But it is what it is. So that's what you do. That's what you do to get iTunes up and running. It's that simple. You would go, and in an Apple computer, you would go into Applications, into Utilities, open Utilities, alphabetically sort, and you'll see Audio, MIDI, and then what I do is I leave it permanently in my dock because I use it so often. So I can go in and I go into Options, and I can tell it to just leave that in the dock, which is what I've done. So that's all you need to do to get iTunes set up and running.
My question, what's the disadvantage of upsampling in the PC?
Divide 96 by 44.1.
You can do something other than 96.
Right. You could do that, which is a rational multiple. But then what you're doing is you're assuming that the computer has a good upsampler built into it. Yeah. There are better places to do the upsampling. Almost every single DAC chip, if you bought an ESS DAC chip, if you were a manufacturer like myself, when you buy an ESS chip, the chip is going to upsample at some point. There's a sweet spot within that chip. There's an ideal frequency that may not even be a rational integer of either 44.1 or 48. But at some point, there will be some upsampling. So just let it happen where the audio guys decided to do it.
Perfect to ask you about, something like pure music would let you handle that.
I'm going to get there. I'm building. We got to go, in some sort of chronological order, but that's a great question. I'm going to do that in a second. Let me just check on our time. What time are we over here? One? Okay, I'm going to have to go fast. I usually get about 2 hours to do this. I apologize. It's a lot of details, and I talk a lot. So what I'm going to do is play some music for you, just show you what we have. No idea how loud this is going to be. Hope it's really, really loud. So what I want to do is I want to play just stock iTunes for you. And then a gentleman in the back asked about something like BitPerfect or Pure Music, yeah, which is what I'll probably use. There are add-on programs that we can use with iTunes. We can take advantage of iTunes' ability to store and manage our data, but we can add higher horsepower engines to this to get better sound. Okay, so that was just iTunes on its own, generic USB cable, MIDI set up right. That's just a fundamentally sound, everything's working right. Now what I want to do is I want to add some software to that that may help to improve the sound of the system. So if you see here, I'm highlighting something called Pure Music down at the bottom. I'm going to go ahead and launch this. And when I launch Pure Music, what happens is I'm replacing the iTunes audio engine with a third-party engine. So there's a number of companies that do this. Amara, Pure Music, BitPerfect, Audiovana. They're all great. I'm ecumenical when it comes to all of them. I don't have a preference. I'm going to go in here and go into my audio preferences since this is the first time I'm launching this. and I'm going to select the device I want to play to. I want to play to the Pioneer audio device. So Pioneer has been selected. I want to make sure it's in exclusive or hog mode. What that means is no other device now can talk to the Pioneer while I'm playing music to it. So there's not going to be any email alerts or chimes or ding-dongs from Facebook. It means that when I'm listening to my music, this application has exclusive throughput to the DAC, which is very, very nice. There's also something here called native integer format support. If your DAC supports integer, which is easy to find out, just try it. If it works, it works, and if it doesn't, it doesn't. Integer will also significantly improve the sound of your system. So I'm going to go ahead and click to relaunch because I just made a change in Pure Music, and that's the way it prefers to do things. And now I can select my native integer, and it tells me one of the things it's going to do is not allow for any digital volume control. And now we're good to go, and I can play that. I should be able to play that same song again. So now it's loading into memory. That make any difference? These programs are fantastic. So I personally, I love using iTunes because it's intuitive, it's easy to use. My wife can use it. My 2.5-year-old daughter now knows how to use it. So it's an incredibly intuitive interface. So all I've done here is I've leveraged two different pivot points. I've leveraged the interface of iTunes with the audio horsepower engine of something like Pure Music. And I think, no, it's not. It's more dynamic. And so this is kind of an interesting psychoacoustic trick. You can make things sound louder by turning things up, or you can make things sound louder by lowering the noise floor. If there's more dynamic range this way, the perception is it's louder. I didn't touch the volume control. All I did was enable a program. So it's they're both 0 dB on their output. That one was Pure Music, but you can try Pure Music, Amara. It would be a third-party player application. It's an add-on to iTunes. Yeah, and most of these guys give you a 10-day, 20-day, 30-day trial. So you can actually download them all and give them a run and see what you think. Okay, so this is great if you're an Apple user. We have a lot of Windows users here as well. Yeah, okay, so I can do a proxy demonstration for you there. So let me go ahead and close this down.
Is that like using ASIO or ASIO? ASIO?
No, it's just a completely, totally different engine that the music is going through. It's not like ASIO, like what you're asking about in Windows. It's something completely different. We're stripping out everything from iTunes except for the graphic user interface. Everything, yeah, yeah. It's more comprehensive than that. If you go to their site, they'll tell you everything about it. But I'm going to run out of time. So if you're a Windows user, my two favorite programs are either JRiver or Rune. And JRiver is a really dynamic program if you're a Windows user. Anybody here watch DVDs? I know, I'm going to audiophile hell. I mentioned video. Anybody watch concert Blu-rays and DVDs? Okay. I own a ton of concert DVDs and Blu-rays, and one of the things I like about Jay River is Jay River can rip all of my concert DVDs. I can rip my concert DVDs just as easily as I can rip my CDs. Now, it's legal in the United States to rip your CDs, and now all of a sudden it's legal to rip your DVDs, but it's still illegal to rip your Blu-rays. But if you lived in Barbados, or if you had internet access from the United States to Barbados, you can go to anydvdhd.com. I'm not telling you to do this because it would be illegal. But I'm just saying if you were somebody who wanted to perpetrate an act of illegality, I guess that's my new word I made up, you can buy software from this company in Barbados and you can rip all of your Blu-rays too. So in the Windows, this does not apply to Mac. This only applies to Windows. In Windows, I can manage all of my DVDs, my CDs, and my Blu-rays the same way. So Jay River is really interesting because it can do so many different things. It has a web browser built into it. If I wanted to play music from YouTube through my system, I could do that too. So I have to go in here and I have to enable the device. So I'm going to select a play now. I'm going to go to Tools, Options, and I'm going to select the Pioneer USB device. I'm going to make sure it's in exclusive and integer mode. I'm going to go ahead and close that. And now I'm ready to go. So if I go to Albums, I can play the same song now from a different program. So if I were a Windows user, there's three really good options I could look at. I could look at Jay River, I could look at a program called FUBAR, I could look at a program called Rune. If a friend of mine came to me who is a Windows user and asked me what should I use, I would suggest they use either Rune or they use Jay River, depending on their computer expertise and the things that they want to do. The reason I like both of these companies is they're both real companies. You pay for their product, but you also get support along with that. So that's really, really nice. One of the other things I like about using Jay River is it gives me networking capability. I can go ahead and I can set up DLNA devices. Does anybody have more than one stereo system in the house? It's okay. Well, I have a few too. Anybody have the internet at home? Okay, cool. So if you've got more than one stereo and you have the internet, I presume you have a router in a house, what you could actually do is you could put different DACs around the house. You could have different stereo systems playing different songs at different sample rates in different file formats to different locations up to 1,000 feet. So that's one of the things that's really powerful about network audio.
Just a yes-no question. Are you using the same NAV and accessing that from Windows and
I am, yeah. I work from home. AudioQuest is in Irvine, and Computer Audio AudioQuest is in Boulder, Colorado. So at any given moment, I could have four or five computers pulling information from the same NAS at the same time. Yeah. Any other questions before I move on? Okay. So I'm going to show you how to set up a network. Is anybody here familiar with networking? Not familiar with networking. Who's uncomfortable with networking? Most everybody. That's why there's IT specialists. So let's go real quickly into this. Rick, can you select on the remote let me see there, the button is at the top right?
Yeah, you want the music server?
Yes, thank you. Okay, so let me connect.
What
Yeah, that'll show up in a second. Okay, I'm connecting wirelessly to start to my router. So I'm wireless to the router. I'm hardwired from the router into the back of this, of the network device. Now, when I launch JRiver, you're going to see the device and JRiver find one another. So you're going to see the Pioneer show up in a second here under Playing Now. This is one of the things that's nice about DLNA. Things are auto-discoverable. The application and the hardware device will announce themselves. It did. Okay. So I'm just still waiting for Media Center to see it. Okay, we're okay there. Could you just change inputs on that for me real quickly? Yeah, just go back and forth. This is why they call it IT specialization. There we go. Okay, so the Pioneer N50 just announced itself. So now they're connected. And I can go ahead and I can play that same song. Now I'm going to be playing over the network. But something I want to do a demonstration for you on is wired versus wireless. Anybody here using wireless for their network audio at home in any capacity? Okay. Anybody ever heard wireless? I'm going to do a wireless versus generic wire. This is not any special wire. This is what you can buy at Radio Shack. But this is really important for you guys to experience because I want you to appreciate the difference between a hardwired network and a wireless network. It's got to get a cable that's long enough.
Can you use the mic, please?
I'm on my Mac, but the JRiver is the JRiver. Whether it's the Mac or the
I think you turned off his mic.
Can you turn on your mic?
Oh, sorry.
Sorry about that. The JRiver in Mac or Windows is the same, except for the absence of video on the Mac side. So I'm going to go ahead and launch JRiver again. And as soon as, and that's the other thing that's nice about a wired network. Look how quickly the devices found one another. Any difference? And this is under ideal circumstances. We're getting full throughput. This is 802.11 AC. This is 802.11 AC. I'm getting maximum throughput here because of the distance. Nowhere in any audio journal or in any AES paper have I ever read where anyone advocated for more noise in an audio system. This is RF interference. This is running at 2.5 or 5 gigahertz, the same exact frequencies microwave ovens run at. So why would we use our why would we use RF interference to move our data back and forth? So it's convenient. It's a great endpoint. I would want wireless access in my stereo system because I'd want to use the application on my phone to select the songs that I want to play. But in terms of moving my files back and forth, this is just generic wire. This was a wire that came with a printer I bought 10 years ago. Any wire is better than no wire at all. When you get about 20 feet away from a router, you start to lose about 80% of your throughput. That's if you live in a cabin on 6,000 acres in the middle of the national forest where there's no neighbors, no cell phone interference, no satellite interference in an ideal situation. Anybody here have neighbors? Anybody open up their Wi-Fi settings and see 6,000 different routers? You guys are all competing for the same channels at the same frequency, so you're picking up a lot of their noise as well. So for a network audio system, your NAS, your computer, your network devices, hardwire everything. It makes a substantial difference. Now, ours. This is where I do the shameless AudioQuest pitch now. So far, so good. I've been pretty reasonable. Ars Techna and the amazing Randy ran an article on AudioQuest, and they said that they asked the question, how do we sleep at night? And they told us we would be going to hell for making Ethernet cables because there's no way Ethernet cables can make any difference because it's just ones and zeros, which it's not. And it's bit perfect, and there's error correction and all kinds of other stuff that happened on the network. So all of these magical things that happen will obviate any difference in cable whatsoever. So this was the cable in question, our AudioQuest Vodka. What is this for a meter and a half? It's $400 for a meter and a half. Now, I just want to say, we also make cable. What's our cheapest Ethernet cable? $29. But this is the one that's sending us to hell, so I want to demo this one. Okay. Yeah. The truth is, we are going to hell, but it's because we traffic in children's kidneys on the black market. It's not because of the cables. Now, so I want to go ahead. I'm going to play the same song again because we've been talking for a few minutes, and I'll make a quick change. And then tell me if cables make a difference. It's the price of this cable is irrelevant. The relevancy is the argument. Do they or do they not make a difference? And then if they do make a difference, you can make your own personal value judgment on what level of cable you want in your system. And if you don't think they make a difference, you can join in on the forum on Ars Techna, and you can say, I was there, and I saw it, and I heard it, and that guy's going to hell. I don't really traffic in children's kidneys. I was just joking.
Your daughter's here.
Yeah, is she still here? I think it's nappy time.
Mine too.
Thank you. stay on low, on light. It's one need, night, one love.
Make any difference? Yeah. So everything makes a difference. I'm going to show you some other tweaks. Anybody here read The Economist? Anybody heard of The Economist? Okay, thank you. The Economist, for 6 weeks in a row, they ran a really interesting science article, an essay on things that we live around that are part of our life, they're part of our universe, they're part of our planet, and we have no idea how they work. Nobody knows how consciousness works. Nobody knows how biological life began. Nobody knows what the chemical moment was. What was the point where all of a sudden cells started to develop? We don't know why organisms need to sleep. We have no idea why we'll die if we don't sleep. We know that gravity exists, but we have no idea how it works. We have theories. We have a lot of theories, and the theories keep changing. Ethernet cables on a social level are not as important as these questions. But the point is we live with all of these things that we don't know how they work, and we accept them. It's okay. We don't have the measurements yet that can tell us why we hear these differences, which is okay. We have no measurement that can tell us what an amplifier will sound like. The only measurements we have for measuring amplifiers is the amplifier competent or is the amplifier incompetent. There's no measurement that tells us if an amplifier is extraordinary or if an amplifier is going to have a rich mid-range or if an amplifier is going to have a punchy bottom end. The measurements that exist that we use for analog audio devices just tell us whether or not we've made competent product or not. So it's okay to accept things if they make a difference. And if it didn't make a difference, that's okay too. So some things I found at home with networking that do make a difference as well is something like this. This is a really cool product. This is a really cool product from a company called StarTech. They're one of a bazillion companies that make these. This is an Ethernet to fiber optic back to Ethernet bridge. So you would buy a fiber optic cable to go with this. You would plug the Ethernet from your modem into this, go fiber optic to the other end, and then connect the Ethernet to your router in your house. Why would I want to do this? You know all that noise I was talking about with Wi-Fi, with all of your neighbors? All of the noise on their routers is getting back to the pole that you're sharing with them. Think about all the noise in your neighborhood that's on the network.
Quick question. If I'm simply running an Ethernet cable to my computer for control purposes, not for sending music in, how much of an impact do you believe that premium cables, optical interface is going to make in a case like that?
Your computer's just a remote control?
The Ethernet's only going in for remote control. No music is being sent to it over the Ethernet.
No difference whatsoever, provided that your network is managing everything correctly. Meaning, what I mean by that is, when you set up a network, if I had just this router here, which has intelligence, it's going to find the addresses of the devices. I have a NAS, I have a DAC. Both devices have their own unique addresses. In theory, what should happen is the computer should send a command to the NAS to go from port 1 and then out of port 2 over to the DAC. It shouldn't go to my computer and then back to the router and then back out.
Right, but I'm using local storage, so I'm just running a cable into my computer only to use an app to control the computer.
Is the music on your computer?
External SSD.
External SSD, but is it physically attached to the computer? So then you're having to take the music from the SSD through your computer and push it out to the network.
No, it goes straight to the DAC.
Where the hard drive is connected to the DAC?
The hard drive is connected to the computer, and the computer goes to the DAC.
So your hard drive is connected to the computer like minus. Okay, so what's happening in this system is this computer is acquiring that data and sending it out on the network.
No, he's saying it's not
kids.
He's basically using...
Is your DAC USB?
DAC is USB.
I'm sorry, I got lost. I thought your DAC was a network DAC.
No.
Thank you, everyone. I'm slow. I get it eventually. Yeah, I get it eventually.
So the question is, under those circumstances, are premium cables going to make a difference?
Not the Ethernet cables. But I could do the same demonstration with USB that I did with Ethernet.
Wouldn't have to for me.
Okay. But this, I think, something like this is paramount. Even if you're not going to buy any premium Ethernet cables, you want to optically isolate your home, your network, from the rest of your neighborhood. All of the routers and the switches and the pole and everything else that's external in your neighborhood is getting into your system and polluting it. So getting something like this, was $250 for the kit, and it's 10-100, which is fast enough for my hi-fi system. If you want to have gigabit speed, these go up to $500 or $600 for solutions like this. But noise is the devil, and noise is the thing that we're always working to get out of our system. So using something like this will make a huge improvement on your system. I would go from my modem, Ethernet in, fiber optic out to the next one, Ethernet out of the second one into my router. And now what I've done is I've isolated myself from the rest of the neighborhood.
Can you run a 300-foot optical cable?
I think you can go even further than that if you had to. Yeah, that's the great thing about fiber optic. Anybody here have a USB DAC, but they'd like to be able to use the USB DAC as a network device? Maybe you don't want your computer right next to your stereo system, but you already bought the USB DAC and you don't want to make a second investment. This is one of my favorite, absolute favorite products. There's a company from South Korea called Sodom. You can buy this in two versions. You can buy just this box with a power supply. This has Ethernet in. It has multiple USB ports out. If I put this on the network, it will show up just as a DLNA device. So you have your USB DAC, and you've decided you want to put the computer on the other side of the house. But you have network. You have Ethernet wire running through the wall. I'll give you your check at the end of the seminar. You can plug this into your Ethernet and then go USB out of this into your USB DAC. They even make one that's spit. If anybody here own a really nice DAC that doesn't have USB or Ethernet, okay. Yeah, maybe you bought a Levinson 30.1, or maybe you have the old Sonic Frontiers SFD2. You have some classic DAC, you have some amazing DAC, but it doesn't have USB, it doesn't have Ethernet. You don't want to make a reinvestment in it. You can order this with USB out, or you can order it with spit out. But what this box allows you to do is turn a locally connected device into a network connected device, and I think these sell for about $300-$350. I think they have a new one coming at some point. I think they're in a lull. They're gonna have another one. That particular model's gone. Yeah, and then you can get an upgraded battery for it. So I actually run mine. I took this out of my system at home. This one is the battery supply, so I don't have any noise from the AC. So they sell hot rods for these things too. Sodom, S-O-T-M, S-O-T-M. So some cool stuff there. Some cool stuff there. On USB, there's a lot of really cool things. We got a lot of USB users here. You guys want to see how to hot rod a USB system? Okay. How am I on time?
5 minutes.
Oh, boy. Okay. You guys are either going to love this song or hate this song by the end of the seminar. But we'll stay just for the sake of it being somewhat academic. We'll use the same song. Right now, what I've got is I've got the computer connected to the Pioneer over USB, and I'm using a Belkin USB cable. This cable is 100% competent. It meets all USB specification. So a couple things I can do for you is I can show you what USB cables do. Also, what Jitterbug does. This is our new USB line conditioner. If I had more time, I really wanted to show you this. This is from a company called Shit Audio. Has anybody heard of Shit Audio? I just love saying Shit Audio and not getting in trouble for it. This is a USB hub. It's a reclocking device. So what happens is I put this in between my computer and my USB DAC. I go out of the computer over USB into this. The data is stored in a buffer, and it's reclocked, and it's resampled out. We're talking about the USB packets and sent off to the DAC. This is $99. You can buy it direct from Shit Audio. And it makes a humongous difference. Everyone at AudioQuest that has tried one of these won't take it out of their system. So it's an absolutely spectacular product. So I don't just plug AudioQuest. I plug all awesome companies. We won't have time to do that today. It takes a little bit to set up. But I will do this real quickly for you just to give you some ideas. Actually, you know what? I'm gonna be nice and try a different song just to be. I know you guys are getting beat up by that. Oh, Rick, can you change the USB port for me, the bottom right hand?
There you go. Working on a railroad for a dollar a day. Working on a railroad, good buddy, for a dollar a day. Gotta get my money, gotta get my pay. Take this hammer, take it to the captain. Take this hammer, take it to the captain. Take this hammer, good buddy. Take it to the captain. Tell him I'm gone. Tell him I'm gone. If he asks me, was I running? If he asks me, was I running?
Okay, I'm just gonna. I'm gonna go ahead and just change out the USB cable. How much is cinnamon? $50 USB cable. Any difference? Okay, people are nodding. Any difference? Yeah, okay. A Linux user finds a difference. It's awesome. You're the first Linux user.
Steve.
Yes.
What was the cost of that cable you put in?
$50.
$50.
Yeah. And then they're telling me I'm out of time. I want to do one more thing for you. Jitterbug. This is $50, so we've $100 worth of upgrades. All right, my USB port has failed. I was doing pretty good up until that point. So I've ran out of time. They're flagging me in the back. I really apologize. For those people that did want to hear whether or not the Jitterbug works, we're right over here around the corner. You can go ahead and do that. I don't know what just happened, but I ran out of time, and I don't have time to troubleshoot the system at this point. But But I want to thank you guys for taking the time out of the show. I hope, thank you. I hope that it was valuable. I hope you got something out of it. If you have any questions about computer audio, you can email us at info@audioquest.com and we'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thank you so much.